Good morning, everybody, and a warm welcome. Namaste. It's really an honor to welcome you all to the 5th Industrial Green Chemistry World, IGCW 2017 Convention and Ecosystem. Welcome. So I'm Krishna Padia from the Green Chemistry Foundation, your host for the next 2 days and your green chemistry facilitator for the years to come. I take this opportunity to warmly welcome you all on behalf of my entire team at Green Chemistry Foundation, our supporters, our partners. So welcome. Wow, what a journey it has been. IGCW in 2009 stood for Industrial Green Chemistry Workshop. So that time our vision or the objective was to bring together like-mindeds and invite various stakeholders to the possibility of green chemistry and engineering, share thoughts, best practices, hear from the global experts. But over the years, with every passing of IGCW, like the passing of autumn, we are evolving, and we have evolved quite a bit. If I can share an analogy, it is IGCW for us is like the daughter who was nurtured then, and with time, how the roles reverse, the daughters start mothering and fathering. Her parents, IGCW from being our daughter, became the community mother. And from Industrial Green Chemistry Workshop, the IGCW became Industrial Green Chemistry World. So it's an attempt to bring the whole world of green chemistry and engineering at the doorstep of the Indian chemical industry. It is indeed very heartening and fulfilling to see how IGCW has become the means for bringing together commitments, expertise, and will. Welcoming that commitment, that expertise, and that will that you all bring along with your presence in the IGCW ecosystem. To briefly introduce, the Industrial Green Chemistry World is India's flagship event. It's held every 2 years in Mumbai since 2009, organized by Green Chemistry Foundation, which is a non-profit Section 25 company. The IGCW Convention Series is our 2025 commitment to the industry and the community at large, with the vision to make the green chemistry and engineering integrated as a way of doing chemistry for preventing environmental pollution and hazard at the source of its generation. With this vision and context, may I now call upon our dignitaries to join us on the dais. I would first like to invite our chief guest, Sri Rajiv Kapoor, IS Secretary, Department of Chemicals and Petrochemicals, Government of India. May I welcome Sri Rajiv Kapoor on the dais. Rajiv Kapoor ji is, within a very short stint of 5 months in the Department of Chemicals and Petrochemicals, he has been taking painstaking efforts in getting connected to the chemical industry. In fact, this is his second visit to Mumbai to meet the chemical industry stakeholders. He is earlier the Secretary of Ministry of New and Renewable Energy, Government of India. He has got his master's in public policy from the Princeton University, IIM Ahmedabad, IIT Kanpur, so it's quite a diverse expertise coming with us today. Please, sir, on the dais. Thank you. With us, we have today Dr. Rajiv Sharma, Secretary, Science and Engineering Research Board. Dr. Rajiv Sharma, welcome. Dr. Rajiv Sharma has a multifaceted career spanning over more than 32 years of conceptualizing, implementing, and monitoring programs in the science and technology arena through various assignments during his tenure at the Department of Science and Technology in Government of India. Dr. Sharma is also an alumnus of IIT Kanpur, where he did his doctoral work on mathematical modeling of physiological fluid systems. He's a scientist G and head of technology mission division of the Department of Science and Technology, which implements nano science and technology mission, clean energy research initiatives, water technology initiative, and the national supercomputing mission. Sir, it's a pleasure and honor to have you with us. Please on the dais. Thank you. SERB is also one of our partners for launching the Industrial Green Chemistry, which is the IGCW Award. So from this year onwards, it's going to be called as the SERB IGCW Green Chemistry Awards. Thank you for moving in as a partner as well, sir. Along with us, we also have Sri Sanjay Sethi, IS CEO MIDC. So may I have the honor of you joining us in the dais. Sri Sethi ji has got his master's in economics from London School of Economics. He was posted as Municipal Commissioner of Thane and Nagpur, Managing Director of Maharashtra State Electricity Transmission Company Limited, Additional Commissioner of Mumbai Metropolitan Region Development Authority, and his present posting as CEO of MIDC Government of India. It's a real honor to have you with us. Thank you. With us also have is Mr. R. Gopal Krishnan. It's a real honor for us to have you with us. Sir has studied his physics at Kolkata University, engineering at IIT Kharagpur, and attended the advanced management program at Harvard Business School. Sir has served as chairman of Unilever Arabia, as MD of Brooke Bond, Lipton, and vice chairman of Hindustan Lever, as executive director of Tata Sons and several Tata companies. He also serves as an independent director of listed companies, ExxonMobil India, Castrol India, and Himas Holding PLC Sri Lanka. Sir, thank you for joining us. Dr. David Constable, Science Director, American Chemical Society, Green Chemistry Institute. It's a real, real honor to have you with us. Dr. David Constable is, before Dr. David Constable, I'll also briefly share about Green Chemistry Institute. It's a committed body that catalyzes and enables the implementation of green chemistry and engineering throughout the global chemistry enterprises. Dr. Constable is with his PhD in chemistry and with distinguished expertise in environmental sciences, air and water pollution. Is the director of was the director of operational sustainability in the corporate EHS department at GlaxoSmithKline. In that global role, he led GlaxoSmithKline's development of sustainability-based program systems, tools, and methodologies. Prior to joining SmithKline Beachcam, Constable served as group leader of the SHEA analytical serving groups at ICI Americas. And of course, this apart, Dr. Constable is one of the mentors for the IGCW initiative, and it's a real pleasure to have you with us once again. Thank you, Dr. David. With this, I also take the opportunity to invite Mr. Nitesh Mehta, the convener of Industrial Green Chemistry World. Mr. Mehta, you know, if I can say in very short, we definitely need more chemical engineers and Nitesh Mehtas in the country. The way he drives this whole green chemistry with that passion, with that commitment, we can, our country can certainly do with few more Nitesh Mehtas. So are you ready to prepare a few more Nitesh Mehtas for us? Thank you. Pleasure to have you with us, sir. He's the co-founder, director of Green Chemistry Foundation and the convener of the Industrial Green Chemistry World Convention. So with this context and background, we would also be, of course, requesting our dignitaries to the lighting of the lamp and invoking God and goddesses for this new beginning. And we'll be invoking the gods of new beginnings and the gods of knowledges. Though it's a traditional and religious practice, it's very symbolic, because as we need that spark within us, this is the spark, which is a symbolic spark that we all need within us to energize our endeavors over the next 2 days and, of course, thereafter. So I would be requesting the dignitaries to once again step off the dais and light the lamp, and then again join us on the dais. I would be reciting one of the prayers, which is for invoking Goddess Saraswati, which is the goddess of knowledge. And those who know can recite along with me. And by the time, we will be also lighting the lamp. Yakunde dutushahara tavala Yashubhravastravita Yavinavardandamanditakara Ya Shveta Padmasana, Ya Brahma Chuta Shankara Prabhariti, Bhidevai Sadavandita, Samam Patu Saraswati Bhagavati, Nishesha Jadyan Paha. So this is the prayer that we recite to invoke the goddess Saraswati, the goddess of knowledge. And for the next 2 days, we are all going to be, through all our sessions and technical sessions, engaged in a whole lot of new knowledge. And it's very apt that we seek her blessings, seek the mother Saraswati's blessings in this auspicious occasion as we inaugurate the Industrial Green Chemistry World Convention. Thank you. Right. So with this, we will formally begin our fifth Industrial Green Chemistry World Convention. And I would first invite the convener, Ms. Nitesh Mehta, to set the tone for the entire event, in fact. Thank you.
Morning. A very warm welcome to everyone on behalf of the entire team of Green Chemistry Foundation. And I want to acknowledge both sets of people. One is a set of people who are contributing to make this happen. So all our speakers, our exhibitors, the domain experts, all our partners, the government and regulatory bodies who have been a partner with us. A very warm welcome to all of you. Thank you for contributing your time and resources to make this entire event and convention happen. You know, the second is the participants, you know, without which the convention doesn't happen. This is, the entire thing is to serve you. So welcome to all the participants. Thank you for taking out time and for your commitment to take green chemistry into your organization. So really appreciate and a big round of applause for you. Thank you. So I'm here to do three things. One, you know, share why IGCW, why are we really doing this entire thing? Two, what's new at IGCW 2017? And third is what's available for you. So, you know, why IGCW is just that we believe that as a community, all of us, like-minded people and like-minded organization, if all of us come together, we can achieve much, much more than if all of us are working in individual silos in our own small communities. So that's where we are trying to get all stakeholders together. We are trying to connect everyone so that all of us can together contribute and make a larger impact to the chemical sector that all of us are connected to. And that's the reason to organize this IGCW, to get all stakeholders together. And it's been, you know, this last 1.5, 2 years has been really, really overwhelming response, whether it is in terms of the number of supporters have expanded. We've moved for the first time SERB as a partner, MIDC as a partner, you know, which had not happened earlier. So there's more stakeholders getting connected. A lot of new industry partners have moved in, which has been, and if we measure all the parameters in terms of the number of award entries that we got for IGCW awards, if we look at the number of participants that we have, so we've got about 400 registration till yesterday evening for this convention, the 2 days put together. So which is a big jump from 238 that we had in 2015. We, in terms of number of exhibitors, we have taken a jump of more than about 30-40%. So when you put all this thing together, it's basically an indication that the green chemistry community in this country is expanding. And you know, while we are very excited to see this overwhelming response, we are, you know, we feel an experience of being, you know, privileged to have this opportunity to serve and nurture this entire field and do whatever we can to kind of forward it. So that's the, and there are still certain communities which we really would like to take them on board, but we are not yet moving in as, and that's the matter of concern for us. The small scale industries, the level at which we would want their participation is still not happening. So that's one challenge for us, and we would need some kind of a partnership from any one of you to forward that. The second is the community of startups. So we still don't have a lot of green chemistry startups, not too many chemists and chemical engineers coming out with new ideas, coming out with new solutions to forward wherever you have environmental challenges. So these are two communities where we want more participation. We would love to create an ecosystem where this, you know, the SSIs taking green chemistry to their plants, as well as the green chemistry startup community can really thrive. You know, a kind of ecosystem that happened in Silicon Valley a long time ago. If that thing can happen here for the chemical community, we could have a lot of solutions, you know, coming into the industry. So that's the background on why IGCW. What's new here is, some of you who attended IGCW 2015, you would know or remember that we declared the phase of awareness of green chemistry over for us from 2009 to 2015. And since last 1.5 years, we've been more engaged on looking at what are the barriers to implementation of green chemistry. So we have marked the beginning of the phase of implementation of green chemistry. And that is where we are engaging. So there are three gaps that we identified, and what we have tried to do in this IGCW is we've tried to create some initiatives to contribute to that, forwarding that gap or kind of reducing that gap. So one is, one gap we identified was in terms of training and development. So how, if we could train our chemists and chemical engineers so that they have certain tools available which they can use on a daily basis to develop whatever product and processes that they're working on. So for that, we have partnered with two organizations this time, the Flow Chemistry Society of India chapter, to conduct a full-day training session on microflow reactors. We have done one partnership with ACS Green Chemistry Institute Pharmaceutical Roundtable to do a full-day training workshop on the solvent selection guide and the reagent selection guide. So this is basically from the context of training and development of our chemists and chemical engineers to give them some tools that they can use on a daily basis. The second gap that we have identified was in terms of giving access to new emerging tools and technologies. So we have a complete full-day session on emerging tools and technologies. The third gap that we identified was between research institutes and industry. And to cover up that gap, one of the initiatives that we have taken this time is we've invited all the CSIR labs to come down and talk about or proactively market their ready-to-commercialize technologies in the domain of green chemistry, green engineering, and environment to the industry delegates who have come here. So we have a separate kind of session, full-day session on CSIR industry interaction. So these are the three gaps that we identified and created some four new dimensions that you will see around here. Another new development that happened, which Krishna just shared with you, was SERB partner. And why it's very significant for us is one, definitely it expands the credibility of IGCW awards, and more researchers and scientists and companies would like to apply for it. But on the other side of it, I think the why it's more significant for us is because it's a recognition of the largest scientific body in the country recognizing green chemistry as an important and relevant field, and by partnering, you're trying to bring that on the forefront of chemical industry. So once again, sir, thank you so much for that. And we are going to have launch of SERB IGCW awards today evening, 6:30 at the same place. So any one of you who are around, please feel free to join us. You're most welcome. So with that, I'm coming to the last part, which is what's available here. So we've got about 60 green chemistry experts, local and international, that are going to be there around with you in the space. There's about 38 experts, 38 solution providers who are exhibiting downstairs, and about 80 people from these solution providers who are domain experts on some or the other kind of technology, innovative technology. They would be around in the space. And you have like-minded people like you, about another 350 of them. So request you to use this opportunity fully. And obviously, from the context of which idea, which concept, or which solution would make a difference to some environmental challenge that you are facing in your organization. So request you to listen to things and interact and collaborate with people from that context. That's our request. And we are here there, as a host for you for these 2 days. Anything that you need, please feel free to contact any of our team members. Anybody that you see around from either NewReka or Green Chemistry Foundation, please feel free to talk to them and ask them on anything that you know. We are here as a partner with you to take green chemistry into your organizations, and we are counting on you to be the catalyst for change. Thank you so much, and welcome once again.
Requesting the dignitaries to share their thoughts. Can we begin with Mr. Rajiv Sharma? Sorry, Rajiv Kapoor, sir. Because the same names are a little, sometimes. So did Shri Rajiv Kapoor first, and then followed by Dr. Sharma as well. Yeah. Welcome once again. And really, it's an honor for us to have you. The word honor sometimes becomes too cliched, but it's something which it's heartfelt for us. Thank you.
Good morning. Dignitaries on the dais, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to express my thanks first to Hitesh and his team for inviting me. In fact, he met me, I had joined this department 2 or 3 months back, and he met me very early, and he kind of convinced me that it is a good occasion to be present and to interact with experts to understand what is happening on the chemical industry horizon. I was new to the industry, I'm still trying to understand what are the imperatives and what are the constraints that our industry is working under. But I think the way it has been conveyed, this appears to be a kind of a solution rather than a problem. As you are aware, Indian chemical industry today is around $150 to $160 billion size. It's very small as compared to the world average, world standards, and we are hardly less than 1.3 or 1.4%. And everybody thinks that we are poised for a significant leap because of the way standards of living are changing, per capita income is changing, and the way chemicals are being incorporated into every field. And it is expected, industry expects that we should be around $300 billion within the next 7 to 8 years. There are segments which are growing even presently at about 12 to 13%, and overall industry growth is more than the growth of GDP. So with that kind of positive push and elasticity, we expect industry to increase manyfold. And in all various segments of the chemical, bulk chemicals, inorganic chemicals, petrochemicals, intermediates, drugs, pharma, fertilizer, all sectors are witnessing this kind of growth, especially specialty chemicals. And the challenge that we would have, we have a large and diverse industry, large units and large number of small units spread all over the country. The challenge would be how do we do it without disturbing the environment, or by ensuring that this growth is sustainable, by ensuring that this growth does not pose hazards to health and to environment. I think that would be the key challenge, and therein lies the importance of today's convention, today's workshop. Traditionally, our approach to environmental management or hazard management has been reactive. We basically, the entire set of regulations, the entire policy is based or premised on you manufacture, we will check. And if you manufacture and generate some waste which is not appropriate, we will penalize. So it's a punitive regime where the basis is inspection by a third party, inspection by somebody else to ensure that we have met the standards. And that is how this regime has developed, and that is why I think the importance of incorporating the basic principles of good chemistry has not been felt so far. If I draw an analogy, this is exactly something like how quality was viewed maybe a few decades back. You manufactured something, the manufacturing would manufacture, then there will be a quality control branch of the factory which will come and they will inspect, they will reject few parts, 10%, 5%. And what they pass will ultimately go as your product. And so the emphasis was on inspection, monitoring by a third party to a laid down standard. So, and that is why we had huge wastage or rejects. And they were not frowned upon because ultimately that ensured that we met the quality. And then the quality revolution happened, the total quality management or Six Sigma, whatever, where the principle was don't make bad quality in the first place. So that need for this inspection rejection should be minimized, should be minimal. Incorporate these principles of quality in the process itself so that output is of quality. I think that changed. Our industry has also incorporated those quality principles. And world over, we have seen a change in the paradigm of quality management. I think the same thing, the same principle applies to green chemistry. And as Hitesh told me, that there are principles, 12 principles of green chemistry. I don't remember all of them, but I think the fundamental principle is rather than controlling treatment, rather than focusing on treatment of waste, focus on non-generation of waste. So I think first basic principle which relates to both economic and physical efficiency is don't generate waste. That requires new chemistry, that requires incorporation of whatever goes into input into the final product, so don't generate unnecessary byproducts, that atom efficiency, the efficiency of not generating anything hazardous, ensuring that there is no toxicity to begin with. So that is ensuring that we look at more and more renewables in terms of our material so that we cause less damage, ensuring that we make products which degrade fast after use, so that they are not posing any long-term damage to the environment. I think, and of course, there are several, and there would be, I'm sure there would be lots of discussion on the basics of these basic principles. But the focus is on creating new chemistries which result in non-generation of waste. Don't manufacture anything. The process does not generate anything which you don't need. And I think that requires a paradigm shift. As I said, it's very similar to what happened in quality. Don't make bad products and then test them. The idea is to make good products to begin with, incorporate it into the design thinking. When you think of a product, think of quality, think of chemistry at that stage. I think that kind of thinking has to permeate. And the challenge is, because as Hitesh told me, that this conference is being organized since 2009. And still, I think it is yet to take shape of an industry-wide acceptance, industry-wide movement. And I think therein lies the challenge, where maybe some big industries, big MNCs, big companies will have already started incorporating these principles in the basic design, because there is a win-win. There is initial investment, there is initial technology which is required, but after it's been, if you don't generate waste, ultimately your cost of production will also come down. If you have energy efficient processes, your cost of production will come down. You will be more competitive. So in a world where margins are under pressure, would remain under pressure, I think this would be a win-win. But yes, it would require initial investment. It would require initial breakthroughs, scientific breakthroughs, to ensure that some of the common chemistries are converted to the green fold. And challenge would be, as was being said, it's not just the large ones. We are also worried about the small sector, the SME sector, which are there in large number in chemical field, and which is in some ways they form the chemical industry. How do we convince them? How do we bring them to the fold of green chemistry? And there, I suppose the role of large units as mentors would be very important. Those who are purchasing their products or supplying, because they can ensure that some of these things, which are cost intensive to begin with, ultimately are shared with the smaller units, which can't afford research, which can't afford new investments. So how do you incorporate these principles into their manufacturing? Because they are in large numbers, and the problem of sustainability is more acute because of some large number of small units operating in cluster, not observing the basic principles of sustainability. I think that's a big challenge, and there, if there is something where government can step in, we would await your recommendations and discussions and deliberations and see what could be done. I think second issue, and SERB is here, is in terms of aligning our research by both private as well as government R&D institutions to crack some of these chemistry problems, the core chemistry problems, in terms of looking at processes and designing chemistries which are greener, if not pure green. And CSIR, DST, both have a huge setup. And I am so glad to see that SERB has fully accepted the working of this foundation and is in collaborating with them, not only to work together, but also to award, because recognition is an important motivator. So to award people who have done work in the field of green chemistry. And I'm sure this collaboration, which should result in more technical advances. And third would, of course, be how to disseminate it, how to take it to interested people and people who should know. And there lies the importance of the events like these, where, as was being told, there are a large number of solution providers, large number of industries and experts. And it provides a forum for discussion and debate and maybe some takeaways in terms of actual conversion, actual implementation of certain things which have been discovered in the labs. So I think all these things in terms of support for research, support for dissemination, support and recognition of people who have done good, great work in this field, they are all important things which we need to tackle. On our side, we have in Government of India, on very small scale, in Department of Chemicals, we have a Center of Excellence scheme where our institution, CIPET, is working on biodegradable plastics and fiber composites plastics. I think we are supporting that, and again, we would very much look forward to any particular proposal where we can support specific projects on green chemistry through institutions where we are supporting, like IIT Delhi is one of the Center of Excellence, IIT Guwahati is another. We would take it up. So overall, I think this is a very important issue before the chemical industry and industry in general. And I think the fact that our participation has been increasing manifold over the past now our fourth or fifth edition, shows that there is willingness and there is huge looking, people look forward to this kind of interaction where they can learn and incorporate something into their processes. So once again, I thank the organizers for giving me a chance to speak to you. And on our behalf, Government of India, we stand committed to this. And whatever we can do in terms of supporting and promoting this and facilitating adoption of better techniques, we would be very happy to do it. Thank you very much. All the best for the convention.
Sir, in fact, I recall our meeting 3 months ago when you had mentioned that, okay, apart from my presence in the morning, what is it that's really expected from the department? And that was something with the first time after all these years of interaction with the department, the first question that has come, that what is expected from the department. So really, it's commendable that, you know, your level leader is already seeing that much ahead. So thank you for that, sir. And just to let you know that we have tried to consolidate our feedback and suggestions and actually submitted to the department's office to contemplate upon it, that if there's any, what kind of intervention that the department can take to further accelerate the green chemistry implementation in India. So thank you for your talk, and I would be requesting Ashwin Bhai to felicitate the tree plantation certificate to Mr. Rajiv Kapoor. Ashwin Bhai, if I can take the liberty, is also the co-host, if to say, because Excel Industries have been supporting this initiative since 2009, right from the beginning, and it's a real honor for us to have Ashwin Bhai with us. Thank you. Yeah. So you have noticed that we have not put flowers, we have not put any of us, we try to minimize the environmental footprint of our event. And to acknowledge the presence of the dignitaries, what we do is we plant trees. So that rather than having flowers here, we plant trees for them, and there are going to be the entire convention. We have close to about 1,000 trees have been planted, so that will sort of take care of the footprint of this event itself. So it's a pleasure for us to plant these trees for you, sir. Thank you, Ashwin Bhai. Okay, so with this, we will be also inviting Dr. Rajiv Sharma to share his thoughts with us.
Thank you very much, distinguished dignitaries on the dais and eminent participants from industry as well as academia. Very, very good morning to you. I am here basically sharing my thoughts as well as actually what are the programs actually we are having from SERB in this area on that. So. You know very well that that UN has come out actually with the 17 sustainable development goals, which are very, very important actually, and the climate is one of them, water, then there are other also actually. Now, Government of India has also actually mapped the its ministries actually to achieve those goals. Now, if we talk about sustainable development actually, naturally, any technology, any process, actually, anything we develop, it has to be assessed actually, in this full cycle, basically. And what are the costs it involves, actually? Not only from money part, but also the social impact, the ecological impact, actually. So those things, actually, we have to consider, actually. So green chemistry goes into a very big way, actually, to reduce those effects, actually, those negative effects, and of course, bringing out the positive effects. I'm really very good, happy that Dr. Nitish Mehta, he has actually included word profitability here. Now, naturally, industry, why should industry come, actually? Because their thing is to actually increase the value for the shareholders. So naturally, profit is very important. And from government side, for us, the last social impact, climate impact, they matter, actually. So we have to basically strike a balance in between. And I am sure actually this workshop is going to talk about those issues in details, and how actually green chemistry as a process can solve. Also, I'd like to congratulate the organizers that this idea actually started 2008, now it's becoming a movement actually. green chemistry movement, I should say, basically, that is, has to be adopted actually in India. And we have to move in, if moving it into right direction, certainly it will help a lot. In DST, because I have another portfolio actually in DST, about water and about waste management, we have several programs actually on that. Zero liquid discharge is one of them actually, and clean water is also one of them. So, we look forward actually for industrial participation into that. Actually, we have programs for technology development and demonstration in those areas. And where actually industry is, participation is requested. Being a government department, actually, we cannot fund industry actually. But what we do actually, we provide 50% funding to academia, academic partner. And we request actually industry also to participate in that. And through cash, through kind, through technology, whatever will be directly, whatever way they can participate in that. Idea is this thing that any technology which is developed actually should not remain only academia itself. It should come to the industry level, and ultimately it should help the society. Dr. Mehta was talking about basically requesting a lot of resources. Now, we are also actually very conscious actually in that direction. And that's why actually we have started a new program in SERV. It's called actually Industry Relevant R&D. It's a 50-50 partnership between academia and industry. We provide 50% of funding to the academic institution. And similarly, actually, industry has to participate actually that way. They have to provide funding, matching funding basically to that effect. It's not a very successful scheme, I should actually confess. Region was this thing that we were earlier focusing mostly on the academic partner, that hoping that their technology will be there actually and then they will find an industry partner. Now, if we are talking about actually this type of problems actually, like green chemistry we are here having, no, ideas should come from the industry actually. That is very important. They should tell us what type of process actually they want to improve upon actually. And then actually we should find a academic partner actually. So we have a very wide actually research base, and SCRB, in its actually present avatar, as well as this earlier avatar as a science and engineering research council under DST, has actually very large database actually of scientists. We have supported almost actually all the scientists in India who are actually well known, who have been actually awarded many times actually in international as well as national forum. So we have actually a very large group of stakeholders there. So we request actually industry to come forward actually, whatever the problem they are facing actually, where they want to improve the processes, where they want to improve the technology. So those things actually, once they come, and we would be able to actually mesh. We also actually have roped in two industry associations, CIA and FICCI. They are our partners in this endeavor actually. And we invite application through those two associations only. And funding is done actually at our level. We do the assessment and we do the funding for that part. So I like to invite actually both the academia as well as industry experts here actually to think about that actually and come forward. Another actually thing I noticed actually very good feature of this event is the workshops for students as well as teachers. Now that is very important actually. We always talk about higher education, higher research actually, but we do forget about actually what is happening at our college level actually, whether our teachers are really good enough actually to teach or to encourage actually students to come up actually and then take this area. So I like to appreciate actually your efforts in that, and SERV also actually very happy to actually support you in this direction. So I'd like to stop here. Thank you very much and my best wishes.
It's really indeed very inspiring that SERB is on board with us in a big, big way from this year onwards. In fact, the students and the teachers workshop all the time has been supported by the DST and the SERB. So thank you for your long lasting support and partnership. Thank you. May I Well, I would be requesting Mr. Adnan Ahmed, who's here with us. He's the region president of Clarion Chemicals India Limited, to kindly felicitate our guest, Dr. Rajiv Sharma. So we'll be again planting trees for you, sir. May I now call upon Sri Sanjay Sethi, CEO MIDC, to kindly share with us his thoughts on the subject.
Dignitaries on the dais, ladies and gentlemen. Sometime back when I was doing some course on sustainable cities, if I remember right, at the London School of Economics. They have this famous thing called the Campbell's Triangle. It's very popular with the urban planning people. So what they normally discuss is that there are these three angles where three E's, that is economics or economy, efficiency, the other one is environment, and the third angle is equity. And they try and tell you that how the conflict will always be there. I mean, so it's not something that you at some stage can believe that this conflict will not be there. The conflict is there, the job is to either resolve or minimize that. So you are trying to bring those angles together. If you're more towards environment, you probably pull down the economic part a little, bring it down close to the environment. If you are discussing the equity part or the poverty, you'll probably try and bring that together. In real life situation, however, in fact, I'll share some of the real life experience that we deal with. What happens is that, let's say one stakeholder, that is the regulators. The regulators could include MPCB, it could include NGT, it could include CPCB. So at some stage, it is thought that this conflict can never be resolved. So we have orders like, very recently, if you all know, these industrial units in Ambernath should be shut down. So we have hundreds of units which we have shut down because we say you do not treat your effluent well, you don't deal with it. So this conflict is, in a sense, not resolvable. So we just shut it. There's another way of looking at it where they say, so I give these parameters. So whether today 100 BOD, tomorrow 30 BOD, so once you do this, then this is completely resolved. Now the other part is that traditionally the industry, especially the SMEs, if you mentioned that, somehow they believe there is no conflict. Because over the years, it was thought that this is how we run our industry, this is how we run our industrial units, so it can go on like this. So there is no conflict. Now the point is that the first point that I'm trying to make is that a conference like this, which will try and discuss these issues, must get into the real issues. So what are we saying? We are saying there is a conflict. We can't be in a denial mode and say there is no conflict. The conflict needs to be minimized, needs to be resolved, and let's discuss what are those mechanisms, what are those tools or institutions which will probably help us achieve that. MIDC as an organization, in fact, deals with this on both sides. A, because we are an industrial development corporation. By the name development, we are supposed to support all the industry that goes on there. The other part is that whatever government regulates to enforce the environment-related laws, to say that more and more industry should be green, we are a part of that story as well. In fact, we are probably one of the largest IDCs in the country, where we deal with as much as about 100,000 hectares of land bank, where so many industrial units, and out of that, we have these big chemical zones, which mainly are in the coastal region, the Konkan region, of course, in the MMR area and Ratnagiri. So over the years, what has been happening is that we have these suboptimal capacities of the effluent treatment. And most of the chemical effluent treatment, when we talk about, I mean, we run, let's say, 23 CETPs with some 180 MLD capacity, but actual requirement may be about 300 MLD. Maybe it increases, it keeps changing. So the first part is the actual capacities of treatment. When we talk in a seminar like this and we say that, okay, so let's not talk treatment, let's talk the rest. But I'm saying that part is, well, I mean, you can't deny that the most important part of this whole story is that if effluent is being generated, well, it needs to be treated. And if today we are talking about recycling it, if we are talking about some technologies to come in which will suddenly lead to this situation of zero liquid discharge, we all need to understand where we are. And I must admit here, say this here, that there is a huge gap there. Where by saying that the Pollution Control Board issued a certain consent and then it said that you will do ZLD and whatever, the gap between actually what is happening on the field and what we are proposing to do remains huge. And we need to do a lot in all these things to reach somewhere close. What we are trying to contribute at MIDC first is, as I said, the CETPs upgradation, expansion, which means increasing the capacities, and of course getting better, newer, appropriate technologies. There is a certain financial model where Government of India supports these CETPs and industrial associations are supposed to run it, where about 50% of the capital cost was being put there. Then something was being given by, let's say, MIDC or state government, and the rest is to be borne, about 25%, by the industrial associations. Over the years, what happens is the norms that are set by Government of India or state government don't keep pace with, let's say, the increase in costs. So if per MLD cost is calculated as 1.5 crores, and on the field actually it has become 2 crores or 2.5 crores, everybody tries to cut cost there, and the actual CETP that comes in there is definitely not optimal. We need to acknowledge those gaps and we need to fill in those gaps. Whereby, as IDC, we took this initiative, we said, whatever that extra thing, MIDC will come in and add to it. Because most industry associations, typically the regulator tries to say that industry associations are a very bad idea to run the CETPs. Why? Because, I mean, if I may use the word, they say ke, you're trying to actually put the thief in charge of what was to be protected. I mean, don't get it wrong in the sense that obviously there will be good associations, bad associations. I don't sort of believe that completely. But the point is that there will have to be a bigger role to understand that this is incentivized rather than there is more and more scope for industrial associations or the industry to escape this. A very big role is of the SMEs. What happens now is that using a certain technology, we have certain capacities of an effluent treatment plant. What happens is that, I mean, this is pointing to the next problem. There is so much of data deficit, data deficiency, that you do not know what those SMEs are really letting out. Now the inlet parameters only are not clear, so it can totally distort what is happening in an effluent treatment plant. The data deficiency part, again, there is a lot which needs to be done. Now we are discussing those real-time monitoring things. We are talking about, in our own systems, having more and more SCADA, where we can have better efficiency in controlling what exactly, where exactly the water comes from, where is it going. So all those things ultimately also lead to a certain asymmetry of information. What is happening is, some information is let out to media, some information is available with the regulator, some information is available with the actual operators. To give you two examples, I was municipal commissioner of Thane some 10 years back. So the I went to see one of those sewage treatment plants. You're supposed to fill in those registers where you say, these are the parameters, how you filled in, what. So I tried looking at that. So that guy had filled in data for the next 3 months. So the data was already there for the next 3 months, which said that I meet all the parameters, everything is fine. So this is the report that goes on. Now, if you just go by that information, that information conveys you a certain message. MPCB does some kind of tests, gets some results and information for those particular days, which sometimes may not be representative of what is happening there. And third is that there are these, again, whether NGOs, whether other agencies, which come into this and get some information. Sometimes media gets information which completely I don't understand what the source is, because whenever I try to ask them the source, they are not ready to part with the source. So I'm saying, in this whole thing, till the time we are clear on those data gaps, this kind of asymmetry can lead to a very, very difficult situation where we are making it a versus thing. The whole debate, I think, here on using the word green chemistry, where they can contribute the most here, is that versus part must go out. We must try the convergence part, the resolution part, where we have to know and understand these are the gaps. It's not like the industry may not like to fill it. I mean, obviously, if you are disincentivizing them completely, probably no. Nobody, I mean, let's say if you talk about, you have to do real-time monitoring from tomorrow. So for that, whatever gadget, whatever machinery you have to put in, if there's a certain cost involved there, so somebody has to discuss that cost. What we are trying to do is, we are saying the regulator operates in isolation, the rest can just go on. Similarly, when we say from tomorrow, the parameters for whatever you have to produce, whatever is discharged, change completely. From 100, it is 30. From 3,000, it is 300. Now the discharge can only be this much kilometer. So I'm saying all this has to be understood with the ground reality. If the ground reality is that for 60 years, the operation is like this, then you have to have those clear timelines for working with this, which is probably not happening, which is, for some reason, last few years, the debate is becoming a little vicious, where the industry probably then is trying to find ways not to comply. And the regulators are probably getting a lot of pleasure in saying that we have done our job. But ultimately, the outcome probably is not being reached. I think that is what we all need to understand. So another point that I would like to raise is about the capacities. When I give you that example of somebody filling in those registers or whatever, at all levels, the capacity deficit is very, very huge. It's not only about saying that the SMEs don't know what to do, but a lot of large units who otherwise claim there is a ZLD, there is a lack of capacity. I've seen it myself. I can only say that there needs to be a much more, I mean, in fact, it starts from, again, as was just being said by the speaker before me, that we need to work on various courses, schools, colleges. I mean, there aren't too many people who I can hire if I look for people related to this sector. It's not environment engineering just, I mean, it's environment management. It's about environment sciences in general. So there is a lot of this capacity deficit, again, which we need to address. As far as your association with SMEs is concerned, I would like to say that we probably can partner with you in this, because all these SMEs are not just registered. We know exactly what they're doing, how they're dealing with whatever. So we could form some platform where we could share that with you, and we could even help you deal with them, because our main issue is also that. What's happening there is that ultimately the kind of the quality of effluent, especially sometimes with the SMEs, that is being completely ignored. But in the end, that becomes most important for us for running these CETP. We are on a more general, broader eco-friendly initiatives. We are trying to, for the first time, look at not just hazardous waste, all kinds of waste, where this waste-to-energy kind of thing also sometimes gets distorted, because the benefits that are being shown are probably too exaggerated. Whenever some firm or company comes to you and says, I will do a waste-to-energy project for you, in Marathi they say, kachre tun sona nirman karne. So kachre se sona nirman karke dikhayenge. So that sona has not got sort of made in the last so many years, where so many such units have just come up with these ideas. The point is, again, there we need to all agree and admit there is a cost. There's a cost to do it. Once we all realize this, then we will not exaggerate the benefits. So this whole thing that was being discussed, then that cost benefit will come out more realistic. And so we will all be able to deal with it better. I think I've said enough. We'll be very happy to partner with Green Chemistry in their endeavors. And thank you very much for calling me here. Thanks.
Thank you, sir, indeed, for showing the other side of the picture as well. And really appreciate you considering that we can have a long-term association to reach out to the SMEs. And here I would also like to acknowledge MIDC's phenomenal partnership this year by reaching out, by sending out circulars to all the associations across Maharashtra to come and utilize this platform. So thank you, sir. I would be requesting Dr. Ashutosh Agarwal, the Chief Scientific Officer of Jubilant Life Sciences, who's here with us. Thank you, sir. To kindly felicitate Shri Sanjay Sethi ji with our tree plantation certificate. I did not mention much about the tree plantation certificate. So there's an NGO which would be doing, you know, which is in collaboration with many other organizations working locally in various national parks and tribal areas. And they associate with them to do this plantation. So what we do is that we collaborate with that organization, and that organization gives a certificate number. So each certificate has a unique certificate number. In fact, they've gone a step ahead. You could even identify your trees on the GPS, that where it is located and where the plantation has happened on your name. So thank you, sir. With this, of course, our second two guests and speakers are also going to be having a speaker slots of parade, but I would still be requesting them to make a welcome note, you know, a brief address to the audience here. We'll be looking forward to their Mr. Gopalakrishnan's talk and Dr. David Constable's keynote talk following to this inauguration. But before we would that, we would just request them to make a brief note. Your talk is there later, but just a brief thoughts if you could share with the audience with the welcome address. Yeah. So we have Mr. Gopalakrishnan, whose talk is scheduled today, so we're going to hear more from him today. But because he's also part of the guest of honor, we would request him to make a short welcome note for us.
Thank you very much. I don't know why I should speak twice. I just want to say that when I speak after the tea break, I do not propose to talk about green or chemistry. You may therefore wonder what is my credentials to be here. I'll probably be the only speaker who's not going to speak about green chemistry. In fact, the title of my subject is, Why Do Smart People Keep On Doing Silly Things? It has nothing to do with green chemistry. But the message and the connection with green chemistry will be, I hope, obvious. But I do want to tell you, lest you think that I am a general economist or philosopher who has been invited here. A few weeks ago, I finished my 50th year in the chemical industry. And I've often asked myself the question, like everybody else, I have to go up there. When St. Peter says, what did you do, son? I am got to be able to look him in the eye and say, you know, I did not pollute the planet through my activities. But I have been at one end of the chemistry spectrum, the consumer end. This chemical industry, which you referred to, $160 billion, going to be $300 billion, is a very funny industry. It's the world's largest industry. It's bigger than the steel and the auto industries put together. But it is in what in India we call a chuparustam. It's not easy to catch, not in a regulatory sense, but in a sense of feeling. It's the only industry where 85% of the output is sold from business to business. Only 15% of the output is sold to the consumer. So you have a long chain where tier 5, tier 4, tier 3, tier 2 are selling to each other. The plain Joe, your wife and my wife, don't hear about this company. Finally, the guy who's formulating and selling L'Oreal shampoo or a Unilever soap or a Procter & Gamble detergent, that's the company they hear about. So I spent 31 years in Unilever, which is at that right-hand end of the chain. And I spent the last 18 or 20 years in Tata. You're making industrial chemicals like soda ash, but we do make consumer products also, like pesticides or agrochemicals and pharma and so on and so forth. The reason why this industry is so difficult to get your arms around is because of this factor, that 85% of the output is sold B2B, and society doesn't be able to see it. So they only see the negative parts. So if there's a pollution somewhere, a lake is spoiled, the atmosphere is bad, it's all these chemistry guys. And that is the debate I'm having now that I've retired after 50 years. What will I be discussing with St. Peter? And so when we come back after the coffee break or tea break, I'll be happy to share non-chemistry, non-green thoughts with you. Thank you for this opportunity.